continuing our root locus rules. So yesterday we had discussed about three rules about root locus, right? So today we are trying to discuss about five more rules, how to construct a root locus by using those rules. I think in the last class we had discussed about what do you mean by root locus? What are the conditions we need to satisfy in order to plot a root locus? We discussed about it. One is a magnitude condition, another one is an angle condition, right? So angle condition we can find out by using plus or minus 2q plus 1 into 180 degree. If I use this one, we need to get an odd multiple of 180 degree, right? So if I get odd multiple of 180 degree, means the given point or a given root which is present on a root locus, which indicates that the given root which is present on a root locus. And we also discussed about example for that, and we discussed about three basic rules to sketch a root locus. The first rule we discussed, that is symmetry. The root locus is symmetrical about real axis. And the second one, the number of branches. If the number of poles which is greater than number of zeros, then the number of branches must be equal to the number of poles. Suppose if the number of branches, open loop zeros which is greater than number of open loop poles, then the number of branches must be equal to the number of open loop zeros. And the third rule is real axis segment we have discussed, right? Real axis segment means if I consider this root, a point on the real axis lies on the root locus if the sum of the number of poles and the open loop pole zeros on the real axis to the right hand side of this point must be a odd. Means what it indicates, you need to identify whether the root locus exists between these roots or not. So in order to identify that, what we are doing, we are trying to mark the point in wherever we want to identify whether root locus exists or not. So in case of here, we are trying to mark the point P in between minus 3 and minus 1. And if I consider this point as a reference point, if I try to count the number of poles zeros which are present towards right of this particular point, that must be a odd number we should get. But here we are getting a even number. If it's a even number, means there should not be a root locus in between minus 3 and minus 1. Suppose instead of P point is present in between minus 1 and minus 3, if I consider the point P in between 0 and minus 1, then what it should be? If I try to count the number of roots which is present right towards this point, then which is a odd number, we'll get a one root which is present right towards that particular point, right? So which is odd, then what it indicates, there is a root locus which is present in between these two roots. So similarly, Q point, if I try to count the number of roots towards right of this point, we are getting a three roots. So 3 means which is odd, again there is a root locus between minus 4 and minus 3. If I mark a point between minus 4 and minus 5, we are getting an even number of roots, so there is no root locus here. So if I mark a point here, so if I count the number of our roots which is present towards the right of this one, we have a 4-5 roots, so again which is a odd one, so there is a root locus till infinity. So today we'll try to discuss about the fourth rule, that is angle of asymptotes. Means once we identify the number of branches, number of starting point and terminating point, the next step is at which direction it will go in order to terminate at a infinity. So in order to show that, we have a fourth rule, that is angle of asymptotes. We can calculate angle of asymptotes by using an equation called 2q plus 1 into 180 degree divided by p minus z, where q value can be identified. So see here, q value can be calculated, that is 0, 1, 2 till p minus z minus 1, where p is open loop pole and z is open loop zeros. So we can calculate a angle of asymptotes, means in which it gives information about how branches approaches to infinity. So the next rule we have, so once we find out the direction of a branches, how which approaches to towards the infinity, so we need to mark that angle of asymptotes on our S-plane, right? At which point we need to measure angle of asymptotes. In order to find out that, we have a fifth rule, that is centroid. All the asymptotes intersect the real axis at a common point known as a centroid, which is denoted by a sigma. The coordinate of a centroid can be calculated, that is sigma, which is equal to summation of real parts of a pole of open loop transfer function minus summation of real parts of zeros of open loop transfer function, that must be divided by P minus Z. Again, P and Z are open loop polar zeros. And let's see the example for this. And we are taken for G open loop transfer function G of S into H of S is of K divided by S plus 1 into S plus 2 plus J2 into S plus 2 minus J2. Calculate the angle of asymptotes and the centroid for this. So here, for the given open loop transfer function, we have three poles and we don't have any zeros because in the numerator we don't have any S function here. So there is no open loop zeros we have. We have totally three open loop poles, and the number of branches, we know that P is greater than Z. Now the number of branches N must be equal to P, that is equal to 3. So this is starting point now, that is P minus Z means where it should be terminate now. We don't have any real zero now in order to terminate a pole at zero, right? So obviously P minus Z means we'll get 3 minus 0 means 3 branches are approaching to infinity now. So the poles located at the one pole which is located at minus 1, another two poles are located at minus 2 plus or minus J2. So let's see how to calculate angle of asymptotes. We know the formula, that is theta, which is equal to 2q plus 1 into 180 degree divided by P minus Z, where q varies from 0 to P minus Z minus 1, right? So where P value is 3, Z value is 0. So minus 1 means we'll get 3 minus 0 minus 1 means we'll get 2 here. So which is started from 0 and ended at 2. And vary the value of Q now. If I take Q value as a 0, we'll get 180 divided by 3, we'll get 60 degree first. Then if I take Q value as a 1, we'll get theta 1, that is 2 plus 1 into 180 divided by 3, we'll get 180. So if I take a Q value as a 2, theta 2 will get as a 5 into 180 divided by 3, we'll get 300. So all these asymptotes are going to intersect a common point on a real axis is called as a centroid. So sigma is nothing but summation of real parts of a pole, summation minus summation of real parts of a zeros, which is divided by P minus Z, right? So where real part of poles, in case of here, we have the real part here, that is 1, and here the real part is 2, and here the real part is again 2 only. We need to consider roots here, means minus 1, minus 2, again another one is minus 2. So minus 1, minus 2, minus 2, and we don't have a real part of a 0 here, so it becomes 0. So minus 5 divided by 3 means we'll get minus 1.67. So what it indicates, the minus 1.67 is centroid now. We need to mark it on a real axis of a S plane. So that at that particular point, we need to place a protractor and we need to measure the angle of asymptotes. So the first angle we have, that is 60 degree. From here to here, it is 60 degree. This is theta 1. And the next one is, at the same point, you need to measure a second angle, that is 180 degree. It is obvious 180 degrees comes to this side. And the third one is 300. Place a protractor on the same place and try to mark an angle in anti-clockwise direction. So we have a 300 degree here. So these three represent angle of asymptotes, and this one is centroid here. The place of the value of centroid is minus 1.67. And another one thing is, there is no need to be centroid value must be a root, must be present on a root locus. There is no need about it. Next, what we have, we have the sixth rule, that is breakaway point. So what is this breakaway point means? The point at which multiple roots of the characteristic equation occur for a particular value of k. So that one we can call it as a breakaway point. The root locus branches always leave a breakaway point at an angle of plus or minus 180 degree divided by n, where n is a number of branches approaching at a breakaway point. So if I want to predict about existence of a breakaway point, we have a three predictions. The first prediction is, if there are adjacently placed poles on the real axis, and the real axis between them, it is a part of a root locus, then there exists a minimum one breakaway point in between adjacently placed poles. So what it indicates means, see here, we have a breakaway point. So we have a poles on a S plane which is placed adjacently, and in between these two roots are a poles. There is a root locus exist. If there is a root locus exist, if both the poles are placed adjacently, then there must be a one breakaway point must be exist. So this is the first prediction. So the first prediction is, if the two poles are placed adjacently on a S plane and if there is a root locus exists between those two poles, then there must be a one breakaway point between those two poles. And the second prediction is, if there are two adjacently placed zeros on a real axis and section of real axis in between them is a part of the root locus, then there exists minimum one breakaway point in between adjacently placed zeros. Means, see here, in the previous case what happened, the poles are placed adjacently and there is a root locus exists between those two. And in case of here also, see here, these roots called as zeros are placed adjacently, there is a root locus exists between these two. If there is a root locus exists between these two, means there must be a one breakaway point. But if we have a two zeros which is placed adjacently and there is a root locus exists between those two, and that particular point we can call it as a break in point, means branches moving away from the breakaway point. So hence we can call this one as a break in point. So next one, the third prediction we have, if there is a zero on the real axis and to the left of that zero there is no pole or a zero existing on the real axis, and complete real axis to the left of this zero is a part of the root locus, then there exists a minimum one breakaway point on left of that zero. So what it indicates, see here, if I consider this one, this figure, end of this one, this is a zero we have. Towards left of this zero, we don't have any pole and any zero, right? So towards left of this zero, we don't have any zero and any pole. Towards right, you may have any row, but towards left, you should not have any zero and any pole. But this must be a part of a root locus. If they are, this prediction is true, then there must be a one breakaway point towards left of this particular zero. This is the third prediction. And how to find out a breakaway point? What are all the steps you need to follow? Those are all the predictions. Simply by looking into a figure or by looking into a root's location on a S plane, we can predict how many breakaway points you can get in a root locus. So how to determine a breakaway point by performing a calculation? So we have a four steps in order to find out a breakaway point. The first one is, construct the characteristic equation by considering a given open loop transfer function by equating it to zero. Then the second step, from this equation separate the terms involving k and terms involving s, write the value of k in terms of s, that is k which is equal to f of s. From this equation try to separate out the values k in terms of s. So next one, the differentiate this k equation with respect to s and equate it to 0. And the fourth step is, roots of the equation dk by ds which is equal to 0 gives us a breakaway point. So once we find out the roots by differentiating this one and equating it to 0, and those root values must be substituted for this k equation. So if I substitute those s value in k equation, then k value must be a positive one. If it's a positive one, then only we can consider this, that one as a breakaway point. Otherwise, we can't. Then the next rule we have, that is rule number 7, intersection of a root locus with imaginary axis. Means, if I vary the k value from 0 to infinity, the root may be moves towards right of the S plane also, right? It may intersect on a j omega axis. At which particular point it can intersect? So in order to find out that, we have five steps here. The first one, what we need to do, we need to consider a characteristic equation first. So consider a characteristic equation from the previous step. You can consider a characteristic equation from that only, that is 1 plus j of s into h of s which is equal to 0. And next one, construct a root array in terms of k. Means we already know it, how to construct a root array from a stability analysis. So once we find a root array, next what you need to do, you need to determine a k marginal value, that is of k which creates one of a roots array row of zeros except the row of s power 0. Why it must be except row of s power 0? Means if this one is 0, means the system completely the system becomes completely unstable system. In order to avoid that, it must be a greater than 0. Next, construct the auxiliary equation A of s which is equal to 0 by using coefficients of a row which is just above the row of zeros. Roots of auxiliary equation A of s which is equal to 0 for k which is equal to k marginal are nothing but the intersection points of the root locus with a imaginary axis. And the next rule we have, so before going to the next rule, we have an example for this, means how to find out a breakaway point and how to find out the intersection point on an imaginary axis. Let's see by looking into the one example. Here we are considering the open loop transfer function, that is g of s into h of s, which is equal to k divided by s into s plus 1 into s plus 4. Determine the coordinates of valid breakaway points and intersection point on imaginary axis. I already told, if I want to find out a breakaway point, means first we need to find out what is the characteristic equation by considering 1 plus g of s into h of s, which is equal to 0. The step 1 is this one, and if I simplify this one, we are getting s cube plus 5s square plus 4h plus k, which is equal to 0. Then the step 2 is, we need to rewrite this equation in the k in terms of s now, that is k which is equal to minus s cube minus 5 s square minus 4s. Differentiate this k with respect to s, we'll get dk by ds which is equal to minus 3 s square minus 10 s minus 4, which is equal to 0. So it becomes quadratic equation, right? So we know that how to find out a roots for a quadratic equation. So those are represent a breakaway point now, that is minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac divided by 2a. So minus b means my 10 here, 10 square 100 minus 4 into c value is 4 and a value is 3 divided by 2 into 3. We are getting one root is minus 0.46, another one root is minus 2.86. Right, so once we got this value, try to substitute these values in step 2. So if I substituted these values in step 2, we'll get a k value. If we are getting k value as a positive, then we can consider this one as a valid breakaway point. For the second value, see here, the k value is negative, we can't consider this one as a breakaway point. So this is only one breakaway point which is exist between two poles. See here, If I try to represent these roots on a S plane, so one root is present at S which is equal to 0, another one is at S which is equal to minus 1, another one is at S which is equal to minus 4, right? So S which is equal to 0 and minus 1, two poles which are placed adjacently. If I try to find out whether root locus exists between these two, means yes, there is a root locus exists. If there is a root locus exists, means those two poles are placed adjacently, means it satisfying the first prediction, so there must be a one breakaway point. And if I come to the third one, we have a 4, means in between a minus 4 and minus 1 is we have a root locus, no root locus. So there is no root locus, means those two are placed adjacently, but there is no root locus, means there is no breakaway point in between minus 1 and minus 4. So this is how we can calculate a breakaway point from the given characteristic equation. Then the next one is, see here, what I told. So C 0 and minus 1, which are placed adjacently, and those two are, there is a root locus exists between these two. And see here, this is a minus 0.46 valid breakaway point. So the root which is start moving from a 0 and start moving from minus 1, means if I try to increase a k value, it becomes the roots are start moving towards a minus 0.46, means the multiple roots can occur at a point minus 0.46, and at which angle it can departure at this particular point, means plus or minus 180 degree divided by 2. Why we are considering 2, means that two branches which is approaching towards a breakaway point here. So hence I'll consider plus or minus 180 divided by 2, means plus or minus 90 degree. So while departing from this point, we need to consider 90. Afterwards, it may be take any value, any angle. Next one, we need to find out what is intersection point, right? So intersection point means, again, we need to consider a characteristic equation, right? From the sixth step, we can find out what is a characteristic equation from that. That is s cube plus 5s square plus 4h plus k, which is equal to 0 from that. By using this, if I form a root array, s cube, s square, s power 1, s power 0. So s cube coefficient is 1, s coefficient is 4. So s square coefficient is 5, and s power 0 coefficient is k here. Then the next row element can be calculated, 5 into 4 minus 1 into k divided by 5. Then the next row coefficient is k. So according to the stability analysis, the k value must be greater than 0. From this, if the k value is greater than 0, then the k marginal value becomes 20 now. Then auxiliary equation above this row means 5s square plus k which is equal to 0. K is nothing but k marginal. If I substitute a k marginal value here, we'll get 5s square plus 20 which is equal to 0. So s square value becomes minus 4. If I try to find out a value of s here, so we'll get plus or minus j2. Means this is a value on j omega axis. So after departuring at this point at 90 degree, then it must be intersect at plus j2 and this one must be at minus j2, and again further value of increasing a k, it becomes a move towards a right off of the s-plane. Then the next rule is angle of departure at complex conjugate poles and angle of arrival at complex conjugate zeros. So angle of departure at complex pole we can find out by, which is represented as phi d, which is calculated by using 180 degree minus phi, where phi is nothing but summation of phi p minus summation of phi z, where phi p is nothing but contribution of angles made by a remaining open loop poles at the pole at which phi d is to be calculated, and phi z is nothing but contribution by the angles made by the open loop zeros at the pole at which phi d to be calculated. So next one, angle of arrival at complex zero means, so phi a which is represented as a phi a, so 180 plus phi, over there 180 minus phi. So phi can be calculated in the same fashion, that is summation of phi p minus summation of phi z. Let's see one example based on this. So we have given unity feedback system, find the angle of departure from the complex poles. They asked here, this is a unity feedback system they had given. So if it's a unity feedback system, means h of s value is a 1 and g of s into h of s will get k into s plus 2 divided by s plus 3 into s square plus 2s plus 2, where g of s into h of s becomes, if I try to find out a roots for this, we'll get a complex roots, that is s plus 3 into s plus 1 minus j1 into s plus 1 plus j1. So let's see how to find out a phi now. That is, we have only a poles here. We have a zero also, right? Okay, we are not finding out our angle of arrival here. We are trying to find out angle of departure. So we can find out only what is a summation of phi p first and what is summation of phi z next. So see here. In order to find out summation of phi p here, you need to draw the vector from the each pole. For example, I'll try to consider this one as a reference complex pole here. For this pole, we need to draw the vector from a remaining poles. After drawing a vector from a remaining poles, you need to find out an angle now. The angle can be calculated by, so this is less than 180, right? If it's a 180 minus tan inverse of y by z means, y by x means, we'll get a one angle. That is called as, we can call it as a theta 1. If this is theta 1, where we have a roots, let's see that one. We have minus 3, another one is at this one, and one is minus 2. Okay. So see how this is less than 180. So we can have tan inverse of 1 by 1. And again, this is less than 90 also. So next one, what we have? We have minus 3, so this is theta 4 now, this is theta 1, this is theta 3, theta 4, this is theta 2. So this is exactly 90 degree, we should not finding out this value now. And this is, we need to find out what is theta 1 and we need to find out what is theta 3 and theta 4. Where theta 1 is, we don't know the theta 1 value, we need to find out that one only. Where theta 3 is nothing but from here to here, right, tan inverse of y by x. So tan inverse, where this value is 1, right, and again this value is 1 again. So 1 by 1 we are getting 45 degree. So right, next one, this one, minus 3 minus 1 we have. So this distance is 2 now, this distance is 1. So 1 by 2. So tan value means, what we can define a tan, please? Opposite by, hypotenuse opposite by adjacent, right? So if I take inverse, which is it becomes inverse, right? So we'll get 1 by 2, which is nothing but total angle they are taken as a 180 degree here. So where theta 1 is nothing but minus 90, so this is 45, and this one is 1 by 2 means we are getting 26.5 minus 180. So if I try to find out what is theta 1, we are getting 108.4 degree. So means the angle of departure from this particular point is 108.4 degree. This is a reference one. Put your protractor here. Try to measure 108.4 degree anti-clockwise direction and mark it, and try to draw the root locus in that particular angle of departure. And again, we have another one root, right? Complex conjugate root. So that is the angle of departure of a complex pole is minus 108.4 degree. Means those two are complex conjugate to each other. Symmetry about the real axis, right? So this is about all 8 rules of a root locus. What are the rules we are discussing till now? The first rule is the root locus is symmetrical about a real axis. The second rule is the number of branches means the pole, number of open loop poles which is greater than number of open loop zeros means the number of branch must be equal to number of open loop poles. If in the second case, if the number of open loop zeros which is greater than number of open loop poles means the number of branches must be equal to the number of open loop zeros. Then how many branches must be terminated at a infinity we can finding out by considering if the number of poles which is greater than 0 means P minus Z we need to consider. If it's a number of zeros which is greater than poles means we need to consider Z minus P. And the third one is real axis segment means we need to identify whether the root locus exists between poles, roots on a S-plane, on a real axis. So in order to find out that, we need to mark a point in between our poles, wherever we need to finding out whether the root locus exists or not, we need to mark a point towards right to that particular point. There must, if I count our roots, it must be a odd number of roots must be present. If it's odd, there is a root locus exists between those two points. If it's not, there is no root locus. Then the fourth rule is, once we find out a number of branches, whether the root locus exists between those roots or not, then we need to identify in which particular direction the roots will approach us towards infinity. So in order to finding out that, we have angle of asymptotes, which is represented as theta, which is calculated by 2q plus 1 into 180 degree divided by p minus z. So where q value can be calculated by varying 0 to p minus z minus 1. And the fifth rule is centroid. Means once we're finding out a direction of direction of our branches which is approaches to infinity, we need to identify where we need to mark that angle of asymptotes on a real axis. So in order to finding out that, we have a centroid which is defined as sigma, which is equal to summation of real part of a open loop transfer function, real part of poles of open loop transfer function minus summation of real part of zeros of open loop transfer function, that is divided by p minus z. Then next to the sixth rule we have, that is breakaway point. So there are three prediction in a breakaway point. Breakaway point means the multiple root occur at a particular point by varying the k is called as a breakaway point. So there are three prediction. The one prediction is by if there are two roots or two poles which are placed adjacently, there is a root locus exists between those two poles, then we need to adjacent poles, what it indicates, there must be a one breakaway point in between these two poles. And the second prediction is if there are two zeros which are placed adjacently, there is a root locus exists between those two zeros, then there must be a one breakaway point. And the third prediction is if the zero is a last root in the on the S-plane, on the real axis, then towards left of the zero there should not be any zero, there should not be any pole, then there must be a root locus exist after that zero, then there must be a one breakaway point must be present. This is the third prediction. So these are all the prediction, but how to calculate a breakaway point mathematically means by considering a characteristic equation by using a given open loop transfer function, that is 1 plus g of s into h of s, which is equal to 0. And the second one, by using the same equation, try to finding out a k in terms of s, then differentiate that equation with respect to s, equating it to 0, and try to find out a roots for that. Next, the next one with I have intersection of root locus on an imaginary axis. So we can finding out this intersection value by considering the characteristic equation and by forming a root array and by finding out a k marginal value from that. And the eighth rule we have, that is angle of departure and angle of arrival. So angle of departure, we are trying to find out for a complex conjugate pole. So if I try to find out angle of departure for that, first we need to consider any one of our complex conjugate pole and try to draw the vector from that particular pole to remaining poles or remaining roots. Then for that, try to find out an angle for that. So finding out angle, so the total angle will get that is 180 minus 5d. 5d is nothing but summation of 5z minus summation of 5p minus summation of 5z. The summation of 5p means the angle which is produced by a open loop zeros, and the summation of 5z means the sum of angle which is produced by open loop poles. Zeros. First one is a pole. By using that, we can calculate what is the angle of departure. Complex pole angle of departure is enough. Another one is opposite to that one, that is complex conjugate. If it's a positive one, 108.4 d, that means we need to consider another one as a negative one, that is minus 108.4 d. Thank you.